followed by the CIDN number. Thank you. Your Excellencies, very distinguished ladies, the governors of Kwara, the governors of course of Akwa Ibom, who is presented by his Commissioner of Finance, welcome the representative of the governor of the state of Osun, we welcome all of you, Your Excellencies. And of course, we welcome our very special guest, an industry address speaker here tonight. I'd like to address him as His Excellency, not because there's a governor before his name, but because of his tremendous meritorious contribution to the growth of our economy and indeed advancement of the banking sector. We welcome, as I said, I'd like to call him His Excellency, Mr. Godwin Emefiele, CONFCIB, Governor, Central Bank of Nigeria. We also welcome Her Excellency, Laura Bilfields, she's the British Deputy High Commissioner. Bilfields, welcome, please. A few days from now, he will be speaking at the third distinguished lecture at Delhi University. A guest professor, he is there, but most importantly, he's our very own president of the Institute, FCIE. Please. And of course, Dr. Uche Emuro, FCIE, first vice president, CIEM. We do also salute our biggest confidential, the second vice president, our treasurer. We salute Mr. Ken Obara, FCIE. She was the two-time former minister for industry, first female minister in that position. Currently, she is the president of the president of APBN, Association of Professional Bodies of Nigeria, is here. Welcome, Dr. Idris Omeje. Good evening, sir. Our own hardworking, I like to call him the Party People Registrar, Registrar Chief Executive CIE, and Mr. Sheye Awotori, FCIE. Good evening, sir. Please give our past presidents a round of applause. I know we have the likes of Otumba Mrs. Oshibogun FCIB here with us. As I said, good evening, ma'am, we welcome you. As I said, some past registrars, I'll do some more later, but please put your hands together for the past registrars of this institute. Thank you. Let's go. Good evening, sir. We welcome the director or representative of the MD. NDIC, we welcome you for representation. But let's also say one welcome to the Managing Director of Development. Good evening, sir, and welcome. We'd like to also say one welcome to directors of the Central Bank of Nigeria and the Nigerian State Insurance Company. We welcome all of you directors. Welcome directors of the CIBN. Welcome fellows and honorary members of the CIBN. Welcome associates of the CIBN. Welcome certified microfinance bankers that have joined us here this evening. Welcome you captains of industry, members of the fourth rem of the estate. Welcome distinguished invited guests. Welcome ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 2017 annual Bankers Dinner. And I think you all deserve a round of applause. Tonight, I will not be working alone. I am joined by a man who telepathically chose to wear the same color suit, same style of suit with me this evening. I want to introduce one of yours, my co-compere, Akin Orakio. Akin, want to join me on the podium now? Yes, Akin. Want to come say your heels. Let's give Akin an applause, please. Something special happened this evening. I got back to my house from where I went this afternoon. Wanted to pick a jacket, the black one.
Para from Osun, from Ogun, from Akwa Ibom, and from other states that may be introduced to us later. Our own amiable governor of Central Bank of Nigeria, this is your dinner. Our own Mr. Godwin Emefiele, FCIB, deputy governors of Central Bank of Nigeria, directors and other staff of Central Bank of Nigeria here present. the managing director of NDIC, other directors of NDIC and management staff here present, my office holders, the first vice president, Dr. Oshie Bisayamu, the national treasurer, Mr. Ken Okpara, FCIB, Awang Baba, the former governor of Central Bank of Nigeria, Chief Joseph Sanusi, our past presidents, Professor Wole Adewumi, Masi Osike Onegu, Dr. Osegun Aina, Otunba Debola Osibode, all FCIB. I am delighted that all our past registrars are on seat this evening. The registrar, Emeritus himself, is here. Thank you very much. Our Dr. Yu Ogunwuka is here. Oloye Esan Ogunleye, Chief Dada, you are welcome, sirs. Let me welcome the Managing Directors of Banks here present, Mr. Albert Wigwe, the Chairman of Body of Bank MDs here present, and other Managing Directors. Members of the diplomatic community, the president of presidents, that is the president of Association of Professional Bodies of Nigeria, Dr. Idris Omede, presidents and past presidents of other professional bodies here present, Chief Mrs. Nneka Akande, the president, Lagos Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Mrs. Demorin, the Chairman, Board of Directors of GTB Bank, the academic community, Caleb University is here represented by the registrar, Mrs. Folake Oko, Professor Emesheta, that is the HOD, Accounting and Finance. Bafo University is also represented by Professor Fosa Kitoye, the HOD, Accounting Department. And Covenant University is represented by the HOD, Banking and Finance, Dr. Mrs. Babagide. Once again, I welcome our council members, fellows, associates, honorary senior members, and other members of our referred institute, my Lord spiritual, I have quite a number here. Thank you, Reverend Awotunde, Reverend Samson Adedokun of New Dawn Baptist Church, that's my own pastor, Reverend Amatiko, New Dawn Baptist Church, and other individuals, guests, special invitees, our members of the institute, our founding fathers, I could see Papa Kasi, who God used to move a motion for the establishment of the Chartered List of Bankers of Nigeria. And if we are here today rejoicing, Mr. Governor, I must thank our founding fathers and founding administrative leaders. Let me once again recognize and thank Mr. A. Adenube, who God used to put in place a structure that we are proud of today as Chartered List of Bankers of Nigeria. I welcome you all to the 2017 Annual Bankers Dinner of our great institute. The dinner affords participants two main benefits. First, it creates a relaxed atmosphere for top banking and finance regulators and operators to interact with other key stakeholders from across the entire spectrum of the Nigerian economy and beyond. Secondly, over the years, we have had the privilege of having governors of the Central Bank of Nigeria reviewing global and national economic landscapes of preceding year while unveiling their plans for the subsequent year. This year's dinner is no exception. We have here today our Amiable Governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, Mr. Godwin Emefiele, CON-FCIB. As I have specially recognized the presence of our guest of honor, His Excellency the Governor of Lagos State, Mr. Akinwumi Ambo, the FCA, to also give a toast of the Federal Republic of Nigeria here today is no less a personality than the British Deputy High Commissioner, Ms. Laura Butefitz. We also have Dr. Edris Omede, President, Association of Professional Bodies of Nigeria, to give the toast of our institute. I commend the efforts of the organizing committee of the 2017 Annual Bankers Dinner, ably led by the second Vice President of CIB, Mr. Bayo Olugbe, FCIB. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it is pleasing for me this evening that, in retrospect, I can affirm that there have been significant improvements in major macroeconomic variables in Nigeria's economic landscape when compared with the lackluster performance of the economy for the major part of 2016. Some of the policy initiatives embarked upon by the different arms of government and ministries, departments, and agencies have started yielding expected results, albeit gradually. From January 2017, inflation rates have consistently declined, while the foreign exchange market has improved significantly, with the premium between the official and the parallel market shrinking from an estimated 70% in January 2017 to about 20% at present. Just recently, the country had a quantum leap in its ease of doing business, as noted in the World Bank Ease of Doing Business 2018 report, from 169th to 145 position, 24 positions better than the 2016 report of the bank. These impressive developments in the economy, nonetheless, the country still lags behind in major social and economic indices. In 2016, Nigeria ranked 152 out of 188 countries in the Human Development Index, a measure of the state of economic welfare of the citizenry, as defined by life expectancy and birth, quality of social and economic infrastructure, and distributive justice. In the course of the year, the banking industry also witnessed great disruptions that have materially impacted upon and transformed the financial intermediation role of the sector. More importantly, payment systems have been hugely disrupted by technologies with an unprecedented ease in transaction processes. The need to address the unavoidable threats arising from this disruption, therefore, becomes pertinent. One of such threats is cybercrime, which is assuming a threatening dimension. CIBN has been working closely with all stakeholders to build capacity required for addressing this challenge. The most recent being the gathering together by the Institute of over 50 judges of different levels of court in the country to discuss the legal implications of this development. During the 17th Annual Seminar on Banking and Allied Matters for Judges, held in 2017, a collaborative program with the National Judicial Institute. My esteemed audience, let me assure you that we remain committed to the promotion of high ethical and professional conduct among our members, as the banking industry is pivotal to achieving sustainable growth and development in the country. In line with this, arrangements are ongoing by the Institute to commence a certification program on ethics, which will cut across every cadre of staff in the banking industry. The Institute has developed effective templates for the implementation of the competency framework as the sole accreditation agency for the framework aimed at further promoting standards and competencies among practitioners. During the course of this year, CIBN collaborated with some agencies, such as Presidential Advisory Committee Against Corruption, and signed MOUs with some sister professional bodies, such as Nigerian Bar Association, Nigerian Institution of Faces of Yours and Valuers, and Chartered Institute of Taxation of Nigeria, with a view to adding more values to the Nigerian state. The Association of Professional Bodies of Nigeria continues to play a very key role in promoting professionalism across the length and breadth of Nigeria. As CIBN plays a leadership role, both in the local and international banking communities, especially with the recent election of one of its past presidents, Dr. Segun Ainun, OFRF-CIB, as the chairman of the Global Council of the Global Banking Education Standards Board. We will continue to ensure that capacity building for industry practitioners remain our cardinal objective. Indeed, we have extended this leadership role to other West African countries. CIBN examinations have commenced in the Gambia, while we have signed MOU with Liberia and Sierra Leone, and candidates are eagerly waiting for April 2018 to commence the writing of CIBN examinations. We will be visiting other countries soonest with a view to helping to reprofessionalize banking practices in those countries. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, as I thank the management of the Chartered Institute of Bankers of Nigeria, ably led by Mr. Seye Awujobi, and also thank members of his team, I welcome you to this year's annual Bankers Dinner and implore you to relish every moment of the night. Thank you for your kind attention and God bless.
Of Dr. Oje Nana, Deputy Governor, CBN, you are most welcome, Daddy. I also like to recognize the presence of the MD-CEO, Diamond Bank, Mr. Uzoma Doze, you are most welcome. I am going there, it's not zero. And so, all this program, follow us tonight. Please permit me to welcome to the podium a man who set out many years Group MD Access Bank, Mr. Herbert Migwe, as he delivers his dinner remarks. Let's give the applause aloud.
Very, very distinguished ladies and gentlemen, please permit me to stand on the existing protocol. And let me once again join the President of the Chartered Institute of Bankers, Professor Segun Ajibola, to welcome you all to our 2017 dinner. You know, the reason I look forward to these dinners is that once it goes past, it means that the year is coming to an end very, very quickly. You know, and we start enjoying it in spite of all the turbulence that would have happened in the course of the year. But it's not a night of speech making. It's a night to truly appreciate all our various stakeholders who have contributed to ensuring that there's significant stability at the macroeconomic level and in the industry. I think 2017 will go down one of the most interesting years ever. When we got into 2016, we came into terrible recession, which continued into 2017. I'll just step back and share some experience I had, I think it was about 4 years ago. I was in some hospital recuperating because I was not feeling too good, and I was walking around in the evening, and I saw a sculpture of a soldier who was in combat. Now this soldier, obviously wounded, but was with a gun. And there was an inscription. There was an inscription at the bottom of the sculpture. And the inscription said, "Peace does not always come free." some of us must pay the price for it. Very, very deep. Very, very deep comment. Because, you know, some of us who are civilians walk around thinking that everything happens free of charge and that, you know, people who are in the military don't pay the price for it. But the same thing happens in the economy. If you are not close to where the problem is, you will not appreciate how deep or how difficult it is to make sure there's stability. Because of the work I do, as the chairman of the body of bank CEOs, I started working very closely with the governor of Central Bank. 2017 was extremely interesting for all bank CEOs. And I think because I have the microphone today, I can say what I feel like, even if I've been punished on Monday. You know, big, big fights. We converted the governor's house on Sundays into a meeting room where all of us met every Sunday. You could not travel. If you were traveling, the governor would call you and tell you that, sorry, you need to be present at this meeting. But I think it's also a night to truly appreciate him for the great work that he has done, and I think he deserves a round of applause. Particularly as we're winding down to the end of the year, and it's clear to us that perhaps the worst is over, and that as we get into 2018, all of us need to work together as a body to make sure we have a much better, much greater country. Too many things happened in 2017. Big issues coming from the center, big issues coming at the macro level. We had to struggle with so many things. And for people who run banks, quite frankly, I think all of us do also deserve a round of applause. I think we should also clap for ourselves, because it's coming to an end, maybe. We're a few weeks to the end of the year. But once again, I think it's also time to also appreciate a couple of other people. I need to appreciate the former governor of Central Bank, Chief Joseph Sanusi. Even from a selfish standpoint, he gave some of us the opportunity to do what we're doing. Thank you very much, sir. And on a final note, one of the founding fathers of the Chartered Institute of Bankers, Chief Otiti, is 90 years old today. And I think we should all give him... Thank you very much for that round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, like I said, it's not an evening for speech making, but please let us enjoy ourselves, let our heads down for the evening, and truly, truly have a great time. Thank you very much.
Being here today, President of the Nigerian Stock Exchange, Mr. Abimbola Ogunbanjo, we also welcome you. Your Excellencies, a very distinguished ladies and gentlemen, continuing with this program, we're switching gears now to the goodwill remarks or address. And to begin that goodwill, I'd like to welcome two times. Please give that applause coming. Shubin Sakonde has a smile that can win a very angry man over any time. You're welcome, ma'am.
Governor of Lagos State, ably represented by the SSG Lagos State. Thank you. I hope you have pardoned me because I'm very close. Institute of Bankers of Nigeria, I congratulate the CIBN for putting together dignitaries and notable personalities from the banking industry and beyond. There cannot be a better setting to wine and dine, and also to network. Since I came in, I've seen so many of my friends here, and I've been doing a bit of networking. Thank you for your kind invitation. The year has come with some upsides and downsides. Every sector of the economy has its share of these developments. Happily, we are ending the year on a good note. Our macroeconomic fundamentals have been very positive. The exchange rate has been stable. Our foreign reserves have been on the increase, and inflation rate has decelerated. No doubt, these positive outcomes are partly a tribute to the effectiveness of the monetary policies under the able leadership of His Excellency, the Governor of Central Bank of Nigeria, Mr. Godwin Emefiele, CON. Although there may still be some challenges, you know, we private sector people, we are always asking for this and asking for that. But although there are still some challenges, the good news is that we are overcoming these challenges gradually. This is therefore a good time to celebrate, through occasions like this. The LCCI will continue to partner with the CIBN to ensure the progress of the economy through effective financial intermediation. What can anyone do without money? We cannot not do without our bankers. Once again, on behalf of the Lagos Chamber of Commerce and Industry, LCCI, I congratulate the CIBN on the occasion of the 2017 Annual Bankers Dinner. I thank you all for your kind attention.
Welcoming His Excellency, Mr. Akinwumi Ambode, FCA, represented by the Secretary to the State Government of Lagos. Welcome, Mr. Tunji Bello.
President, or should I say the Governor of Central Bank, other distinguished bankers, ladies and gentlemen, His Excellency will not be here today because he has to attend the Governor's meeting, which is holding in Kaya at the moment. So he has to represent him. He sends his best wishes, and should I just say, have a wonderful evening. Thank you.
This is a first for me. Your Excellencies, very distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the year 2017, as alluded to by the President of the LCCI, has been one with a lot of ups and downs. The British will call it a topsy-turvy year. But for us, we're thankful that in the end, before the end of the year, we jumped out of a very poor position in the ease of doing business ranking to where we currently stand. It is the business of the CIBN to indeed extray what the economy has been throughout the year. In the next couple of minutes, we'd like to present to you this documentary that is looking at the Nigerian economic landscape, the key events of 2017. I implore you to sit back and take away the stories.
It's the fundamental social and economic changes that are redefining formerly entrenched business models. Technology continues to be a game-changer in the scheme of things. Against the backdrop of a lackluster performance in 2016, the International Monetary Fund, IMF, predicted that economic activities would increase in 2017 and 2018, especially in emerging markets and developing economies. In its October 2017 World Economic Outlook, the IMF noted that the global upswing in economic activity is strengthening, with global growth projected to rise to 3.6% at the end of 2017, as against 3.1% in 2016. On the domestic front, notable changes in business dynamics were also experienced. Nigeria was ushered into 2017 with a less than encouraging economic growth performance, due largely to the July 2016 plunge into recession. Highlights of major macroeconomic trends in the country and events in the banking industry in 2017. Inflation rate from 18.55% in December 2016 peaked at 18.72% in January 2017. From February 2017, the rate consistently dropped, reaching 15.98% in September 2017, the lowest in 16 months. From January to early February 2017, exchange rate in the parallel market was around 500 naira to a dollar, while the official rate remained pegged at 305 naira, a premium of 64%. The Central Bank of Nigeria CBN from February 2017 has sustained its intervention in the country's foreign exchange market through dollar injection. While the official exchange rate remains pegged at 305 naira, the parallel market rate has fluctuated between 360 naira and 365 naira since the third quarter of the year. Up to date, the Monetary Policy Committee MPC has retained monetary policy rate MPR at 14%. In April 2017, the federal government, through the Ministry of Budget and National Planning, launched the Economic Recovery and Growth Plan, ERGP, for the nation. In the same month, CBN opened a foreign exchange window, specifically for small and medium enterprises, SMEs, in order to improve activities in the sector. Similarly, the Apex Bank opened a special foreign exchange window for investors and exporters. The investors and exporters FX window was intended to boost liquidity in the forex market and ensure timely execution and settlement for eligible transactions. To further facilitate access of SMEs to finance, the then acting president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Professor Yemi Osinbajo, in May 2017 assented to the Secured Transactions Immovable Assets Bill 2017 and the Credit Reporting Bill 2017 as passed by the National Assembly. In June, the federal government issued its first diaspora bond in the international capital market, raising the sum of $300 million at a coupon rate of 5.625% for a tenure of 5 years. After five consecutive quarters of negative growth, the National Bureau of Statistics, NBS, in its 2017 second quarter gross domestic product GDP report, announced Nigeria's exit from recession. The economy grew at 0.55% year-on-year in real terms in the second quarter of 2017. In July, CBN released exposure draft on the regulatory framework for bank verification number BVN operations and watchlist for the Nigerian financial system. In August, International Monetary Fund IMF projected that Nigeria would record an economic growth of 0.8% in 2017. As at the end of September, CBN had expended 43.92 billion naira to fund its Anchor Borrowers Program, established in 2015 to assist smallholder farmers in accessing funds and promote employment generation. In October, CBN announced that it had recovered over 50 billion naira as excessive charges imposed on customers. Also, Mrs. Aisha Ahmed was nominated as the new Deputy Governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria to succeed Dr. Mrs. Sarah Alade, OOM-FCIB, who retired as the Deputy Governor Economic Policy, CBN, in March 2017. The World Bank Ease of Doing Business Report in 2018 placed Nigeria in the 145th position among 190 economies, 24 positions better, and the 169th position position was ranked in the 2017 shortages due to the Bankers of Nigeria, CIBN, in 2017. On January 24, 2017, the Institute, through its subsidiary, CIBN-CFS, organized a roundtable session on Third Economic Outlook, Implications for Businesses in Nigeria in 2017, in collaboration with B. Adetiba Associates Limited. The keynote address of the event that attracted prominent players in the country's economic value chain was delivered by Professor Akpan Ego, the Director General West African Institute for Financial and Economic Management, YFM, 22nd World Conference of Banking Institutes. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the high point of CIBN activities in 2017 was the host of the 22nd World Conference of Banking Institutes, WCBI, with their co-hotels and suites in Tule Island, Lagos, from April 24 to 28, 2017. The conference, which had over 1,000 participants from 32 countries, was adjudged the most successful WCBI by participants with 7 testimonials. It is also gratifying to note that the launch of the Global Banking Education Standards Board, GBESTB, coordinated by CIBN, took place at the conference. The GBESTB has the mandate of designing industry-led initiative which aims to develop clear, internationally agreed standards for the education of professional bankers. Incidentally, on July 25, 2017, a past president of CIBN, Dr. Lawrence Olusegun Aina, OFR-FCIB, was elected as the pioneer chairman of the GBESTB. Dr. Aina would lead the Global Council, comprising 26 founder member institutes for the next 2 years. He has been ably assisted by 3 vice chairmen: Mr. Simon Thompson of the Chartered Banker Institute Scotland, Ms. Carrie Liu of the Hong Kong Institute of Bankers, and Mr. Anthony Yor-Opong of the Chartered Institute of Bankers Ghana. The 22nd WCBI was preceded by the first National FinTech Conference in Nigeria, organized on April 24, 2017 by the Chartered Institute of Bankers of Nigeria Center for Financial Studies, CIBN-CFS, a subsidiary of CIBN, in collaboration with the FinTech Associates Limited and Digital Finance Institute Canada. The Honorable Minister of Industry, Trade and Investment, Dr. Okechukwu Enenwa, delivered the keynote address at the event. CIBN knowledge events and capacity building programs for industry practitioners in 2017. At various times in the year, the CIBN CFS Learning and Development and Continuing Compulsory Professional Development CCPD e-learning divisions of the CIBN organized knowledge events, training workshops, conferences on emerging topical issues such as cryptocurrency, financial system integrity improvement, financial literacy, effective management of pension funds, mortgage lending and real estate financing, concept of corporate governance, asset and liability management ALM, collateral registry act, strategic communications management, amongst others. A number of these programs are held in collaboration with reputable institutions and agencies, such as the Presidential Advisory Committee Against Corruption, PACAC, Association of Certified Chartered Accountants, ACCA, Nigerian Institution of Estate Surveyors and Valuers, NIESE, Nigerian Interbank Settlement System, NIBSS, and the Nigerian Institute of Public Relations, NIPR. CIBN 2017 Statutory Programs. The 2017 Annual General Meeting, AGM, took place on Saturday, May 20, 2017. The AGM was well attended by stakeholders across different sectors of the economy. The 2017 Annual Lecture, with the theme National Integration, Citizenship, and the Challenge of Economic Policymaking, was delivered by Professor Osita Obu, Professor of Economics and Director, Institute for Development Strategies at the University of Nigeria in Suga, and a former Minister and Economic Advisor to the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. The lecture was chaired by Mr. Aiguje Aigimogwede, CON, FCIB, the President of the Nigerian Stock Exchange. Similarly, the 2017 CIBN Graduates Induction Prize Awards Day was held on August 26, 2017, at the Harbour Point, Victoria Island, Lagos. associates of the Chartered Banker MBA, 234 associates ECIPs, 689 Microfinance Certified Bankers MCIP, and 69 diploma graduates were inducted. A pleasant departure from the norm at the 2017 CIBN induction program was the induction of the first set of qualified ACIPs from the Gambia. The Institute's anthem was also unveiled and rendered for the first time in the history of the Institute during the 2017 CIBN Graduates Induction and Prize Awards Day. It is also instructive to note that the Institute has succeeded in expanding its space of knowledge and capacity building in other African countries of Liberia and Sierra Leone. On Monday, May 15, 2017, in Monrovia, Liberia, the Institute executed an agreement with the Central Bank of Liberia, CBL, and the Liberia Bankers Association, LBA, for the establishment of CIBN Local Examination Center in the country. Similarly, the CIBN team, led by the President, Chairman of Council, Professor Shedwin Ajibola, PhD, FCIB, was in Sierra Leone in October 2017 in preparation towards the commencement of CIBN examinations in the country. The Institute's Entrepreneurship Development Program, EDP, Public Presentation and Practice License, was held on October 6, 2017. The 17th National Seminar on Banking and Allied Matters for Judges, a collaboration between CIBN and the National Judicial Institute at NJI, was held from October 17 to 18, 2017 at the National Judicial Institute of Abuja, with the theme, Emergence of New Frontiers in Banking and Its Legal Implications. The seminar was declared open by the Chief Justice of the Federation, Honorable Justice Walter S.N. Onoghue, CON, CFR, GCON, who was represented by a Justice of the Supreme Court, Honorable Justice M.D. Mohammed. The seminar had in attendance 52 judges, 29 senior executive of banks, and 15 delegates from different law enforcement agencies. The 2017 CIBN Fellowship Investiture had as its highlight the conferment of honorary fellowship of 11 distinguished professionals, one of the highest number in the Institute's 54 years history. The honorees include the Deputy Governor, Financial System Stability, Central Bank of Nigeria, Dr. Joseph Nana, FCIB, Mr. Alvin Milton Weeks, FCIB, Executive Governor, Central Bank of Liberia, and Mrs. Tukumba Martins, FCIB, Director, other Financial Institutions Department, Central Bank of Nigeria. Other honorees are top practitioners in the industry and renowned consultants on banking and finance-related issues. Investiture was also the first time CIBN would elect into the honorary fellowship category someone from outside the shores of Nigeria, in person with Mr. Milton Alvin Weeks, FCIB, Executive Governor of the Central Bank of Liberia. Total of 119 professionals from the banking and finance industry, academics, consultants, public service, amongst others, were also elected as fellows of the Institute, while 62 top executives in the banking industry, other financial institutions, and the academics were awarded honorary senior members, HCIB. CIBN examinations. The Institute's examinations were held in April and October 2017. It is, however, cheering to note that the pilot of the computer-based test, CBT, was conducted during the October 2017 diet in Lagos and Abuja. This is a landmark achievement as the Institute begins the process of transiting to CBT examinations in response to contemporary trends. With this development, the Institute has made more flexible the path to becoming a chartered banker. The CBT examinations are expected to become fully operational in 2018 in all the states across the country where the Institute's examinations are currently holding. In a related development, the Institute's e-learning platform is now fully operational and currently in use by students and professional members of the Institute. Stakeholders and regions. In the course of the year, the President, Chairman of Council, CIBN, engaged with over 60 local and international stakeholders of the Institute. Among these were traditional rulers such as the Oromi of Ife, Obi of Onitsha, and the Oman of Lagos, Southern Interior, state governors of Bayelsa, Bauchi, Plateau, Delta, and Edo states. Regulators, operators, academic communities, other professional bodies and associations, and the Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation and NPC, European Investment Bank, the Chartered Institute of Management Accountants, Association of Corporate Affairs Managers of Banks in Nigeria, Risk Managers Association of Nigeria, REMAN, and the Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation, NNPC. Implementation of the competency framework in the discharge of its role as the sole accreditation agency under the Central Bank of Nigeria competency framework for the banking industry. The Institute organized a press conference to create public awareness of the conscious steps being taken by CIBN to redirect the banking industry towards the path of entrenching a sequenced competency development program and ensure that the staff of banks qualify for the job roles they occupy. A workshop for heads of human resources of banks and other financial institutions was also organized by the Institute on August 8, 2017, with the sole objective of carrying key stakeholders along in the implementation of the framework. By the end of the year, all banks, academies except one, would have been accredited together with over 30 educational training services providers, ETSPs. Also, a total of 10 institutions would have been linked with the Institute, bringing the total number of linkage institutions to 55. Ethics and professionalism.
Thank you.
Thank you. I stand on existing protocol. I'm here to introduce a very important man in banking in Nigeria, Mr. Godwin Emefiele, CON, FCIB, is the governor of Central Bank of Nigeria, CBN. He was a lecturer in finance and insurance. He was the former group managing director of Zenibank PLC before he became the governor of Central Bank. He holds degrees in banking and finance from the University of Nigeria, Nzukka. He's an alumnus of Stanford University, Harvard, Winton, Graduate Schools of Business. He vigorously pursues his vision of financial system stability and developmental finance. He has a strong belief that central banks in developing countries must not only concentrate on price and monetary stability. For this reason, he held on to his vision of job creation by the establishment of Central Bank of Nigeria's anchor borrower scheme. The program has made it largely possible for significant rice outputs across the country, and has also enabled a lot of Nigerians by creating employment. Mr. Godwin Emefiele is happily married with children. I present to you this evening a special guest of honor and proudly our Central Bank Governor, Mr. Godwin Emefiele, CON, FCIB. Can we stand up and appreciate our governor? Thank you very much.
Excellency, the Executive Governor of Lagos State, represented by the Secretary to the Government of Lagos, Mr. Tunji Bello, the former Governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, Chief Joseph Sanusi, the President of CIBN, Professor Ajibola, and members of the Executive Council of the CIBN, Deputy Governors and members of the Committee of Governors of Central Bank of Nigeria, I think at this stage, please let me just rest on the already established protocol. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and members of the press. Good evening to you all. I am truly delighted once again to be given the honor to address this eminent gathering of the very best people in our country's financial industry. It is profoundly dignifying for me, not just for the opportunity to address this eminent gathering, but fundamentally because you have found it worthy to attend and listen to me despite your very busy schedules. Indeed, this event is so special to us at the Central Bank because it always affords us an opportunity to share our insights with you on the various policies and matters that we have dealt with in the current year, and then also seize an opportunity to propose what we think may happen in the coming year. Let me especially thank the brains and the bronze behind this dinner, Professor Segun Ajibola, Mr. Seyi Awojobi and their team at the Chartered Institute of Bankers for their relentless effort at ensuring that the event is successful. I'd like to recognize and appreciate the presence of the Managing Director and Chief Executive of our deposit money banks and other financial institutions who have all made time to be here this evening. The presence of my colleagues from the Central Bank of Nigeria, especially our deputy governors, directors, special advisors, assistants, senior management of the bank, are all respectfully acknowledged and appreciated. And to everyone else present at this gathering, I welcome you heartily and thank you for coming. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, my address this evening, which I have titled Policy Options for Sustaining Nigeria's Economic Upturn, I'll provide updates on developments within the Nigerian economy, share some insights into CBN's current efforts at the macroeconomic and financial policies, and provide a glimpse of our thoughts based on our personal understanding of the present economic situation of our country, and will thereafter discuss some solutions to sustaining our exit from recession. When I spoke at last year's dinner, the general aura in the hall was fretful, uncertain, and anxious given the precarious position of the macroeconomy at that time and the recession that beleaguered Nigeria in 2016. Key macroeconomic and financial metrics for October 2016, which were available at last year's event, were not only demoralizing, but also worrisome. At that time, the gross domestic product had for the third consecutive quarter contracted by 2.3%, with further contractions expected in the fourth quarter. Inflation had doubled to 18.3% in October 2016 from 9.6% in January 2016. Persistent depletion of FX reserves seemed irreversible, with a balance of $23.6 billion at the end of October 2016, while downward exchange rate pressures intensified. Plummeting stock market indicators, sustained net capital outflows, and poor doing business indicators all characterized our economy when I gave my speech this time last year. At that time, as many of you would recall, I sounded a few strings of hope for impending recovery dependent on us, collectively and individually, doing the right things. Though many at that time thought I was being overly optimistic or politically correct, today we all are glad to see that the hitherto unpleasant conditions have largely reversed. We as a resilient people are responsible organizations have collectively surmounted the worst and have huddled the unwelcome recession. There is today a fresh and resurgent glimmer of reassurance in the horizon. But the question therefore is, what has changed since last year's dinner? What did we do right, and how do we sustain what we did right? Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, as you will recall, there has been three major exogenous shocks over the last couple of years, namely oil price decline, geopolitical tensions, global growth slowdown, and the US monetary policy normalization. These shocks have had significant adverse consequences on Nigeria's economy, including one, depressed GDP growth, which culminated in a recession with five consecutive quarters of GDP contraction, bottoming at -2.3% during the third quarter of 2017, having grown by nearly 7% in previous years. Two, rising inflation, peaking at over 18% in January 2017, from as low as 9% in January 2016. Three, persistent increase in unemployment rate to 14.23% in October during the fourth quarter of 2016, from 6.41% as at the fourth quarter of 2014. Four, significant depreciation of the exchange rate, reaching 525 naira to the dollar in February 2017, from as low as 155 naira to the dollar in January 2014. Five, depletion in FX reserves, bottoming at about $23.6 billion in October 2016, from as high as $40 billion in January 2014. Five, substantial decline in average inflows of foreign exchange into the CBN by over $2.3 billion every month over a three-year period. Six, strain on the financial market with declines in key money, capital, and foreign exchange market indicators. Seven, weakening resilience of the Nigerian banking sector, though the industry remained largely robust, as NPLs deteriorated in line with difficulties of the macroeconomy, and banking system exposure to foreign loans threatened to undermine their health. Eight, constrained fiscal space leading to large fiscal deficits and rising debt profile. Though the debt to GDP ratio remains significantly robust and below the 30% threshold, debt service to revenue ratio is comparatively unsustainable. Nine, given the sharp drop in oil prices, Federation account allocation to states have dropped by an average of 2 billion naira monthly per state, which partly explains their inability to meet some basic recurrent expenditures, including payment of workers' salaries. Why was Nigeria so adversely affected by these exogenous shocks? Ladies and gentlemen, it is because we drained our buffers by an excessive dependence on imports of mostly frivolous goods. It is not surprising that we were so heavily affected because oil accounts for over 90% of our exports and nearly 70% of fiscal revenue. So given a more than 60% decline in oil prices and its attendant effect on foreign exchange and fiscal earnings, it is not surprising that our economy suffered so gravely. Besides, the structural imbalance of Nigerian economy with over-reliance on imported goods added to our problem. While growth declined, the rise in inflation was inevitable as falling exchange rate and rise in foreign prices passed through directly to domestic prices. Now, contrary to correct policy prescriptions, during the times of boom, we opened up our economy to all comers and dropped all capital controls. At some point, we had more than $23 billion in foreign portfolio inflows in a particular year. Monies that could easily evaporate at the slightest hint of an economic slowdown. Recall that in September 2008, Nigeria's FX reserve hit a whopping $62 billion, even after we had spent about $12 billion settling our external debt obligations. What did we do with the money? Rather than build on the one-time burgeoning base of agricultural production and manufacturing we had, we invested less in power, less in infrastructure, less in education and health. As our schools began to dilapidate and teachers went on incessant strikes, we sent our children overseas, even for primary school education. As doctors preferred to practice in the US and the UK, and hospitals lacked even hand gloves and indeed syringes. We embarked on a medical exodus abroad, even for basic diagnostics. As our manufacturing companies started closing, especially for lack of power, we gladly substituted them with seemingly cheap imports while inadvertently exporting jobs and importing poverty to our nation. How did we tackle these problems? What was the role of the CBN during those difficult times? Distinguished guests, based on our understanding of the development and traverse of the future as shown by exhaustive scenarios from our in-house macroeconomic simulations and analysis, the bank took a number of proactive measures, many of which were, at that time, at some point vigorously criticized. Some of these policies include, in the area of monetary policy, we embarked on a cycle of tightening to rein in inflation with the monetary policy rate hiked in July 2016 from 12% to prevailing 14% and maintained there since that time. We have also used open market operations to support our restrictive policy stance. I must inform that members of the bank's monetary policy committee, in arriving at these decisions, critically juxtaposed objectives of price stability with the benefits of growth recovery. Based on balance of evidence, expert judgment, and boldness, with the consensus of the committee was that the welfare gains of rapidly achieving price stability outstripped the benefit of an overriding focus on output stabilization. Nonetheless, considerations of output recovery were always embedded in every MPC decision. In external reserves management, as a means of controlling the drain on reserves, we adopted demand management through the restriction of FX for import of goods that can be produced in Nigeria. We established a decisive withdrawal of the de facto subsidy for the importation of 41 items non-essential commodities with unfolding successes. In the area of exchange rate management, the CBN took a number of actions to stabilize the exchange rate amid escalated pressures from speculators, bettors, round-trippers, and rent seekers. The CBN encouraged increased FX inflows from remittances by licensing more IMTOs, more FX sales into the interbank market, as well as establishment of the investors' exporters window in April 2017. The introduction of the NAFEX market and the investors and exporters FX window increased transparency of market and has helped stabilize our exchange rate. We have seen improved sentiment as Nigeria becomes a hub of investment in Africa and among emerging market economies. In the area of development finance, aimed at diversifying the economy away from overdependence on oil revenues for financing the budget and source of FX inflows and consistent with the development agenda, the CBN continued its development finance activities, targeted interventions at specific high impact sectors like agriculture, including introducing the Ankokura program. To date, the bank has committed close to 45.5 billion naira under the Ankokura program, with active participation across 30 states of the Federation. In Kebbi State alone, over 78,000 smallholder farmers are now cultivating about 100,000 hectares of rice farms in 2016. It is expected that over 2 million metric tons of rice will be produced in that state alone annually. We remain committed to doing more in the targeted crops such as rice, maize, palm oil, sorghum, tomatoes, cassava, cocoa, cotton, dairy, and groundnut. To consolidate on the gains of the Ankokura program and reach more deserving smallholder farmers nationwide, the CBN is forming strategic partnerships with agricultural commodity associations. These strategic partnerships have already started yielding results with the commencement of the Rice Farmers Association RIFAN Ankokura program, where about 300,000 rice farmers across 20 states will be supported under the upcoming dry season cultivation. An additional 2 million metric tons of paddy rice is expected to be produced under the RIFAN Ankokura program. This is in addition to the various private sector and state government-led collaborative initiatives being implemented at this time. Now, in the light of these and other policy responses, we are delighted that the economy has turned a corner with our worst days clearly behind us. For example, after 5 consecutive quarters of contraction of GDP, beginning from the first quarter of 2016, the economy recorded a positive growth of 0.55% during the second quarter of 2017, faced the negative outcomes of -1.73% and -0.91% during the fourth quarter of 2016 and first quarter of 2017, respectively, signaling an exit from recession. On inflation, from a peak of 18.72% in January 2017, headline inflation recorded 8 straight months of disinflation, with the rate declining to 15.98% in September 2017. During this period, core inflation and imported food inflation similarly fell from 17.9% and 20.95% respectively to 12.12% and 14.83%. Food inflation, however, rose from 17.8% to 20.3%. The inertia exhibited by food prices inflation reflected, among other things, the rising price of farm inputs and supply shortages, intermittent clashes between farmers and herdsmen, as well as the lingering problems in the Nigerian northeastern region, which affected agricultural output. On exchange rate, we have seen a significant appreciation of the Naira from over 500 Naira to the dollar to about 360 Naira to the dollar. In addition, we have seen stability in the rate of over 6 months, for over 6 months now, and I'm glad to note that exchange rate is not only stable, it is also converging across various windows and segments of the market. Regarding FX supply, since the establishment of the investors and exporters window, we have recorded about $10 billion in autonomous inflows through this window alone. This reflected the effects of the increased transparency which that window accorded the FX market and participants, and its benign impact of improving investor confidence and business sentiment. In the area of FX reserves, our reserves have recovered significantly from a low of just over $23 billion in October 2016 to over $34.3 billion as at November 3, 2017. The accretion in reserves does not only reflect increased inflow, but also shift of FX demand management strategy. When we introduced the policy of restricting 41 items from our FX market, we were called all manner of names. Today, ladies and gentlemen, among the benefits of that policy is the considerable decline in our import bills from an average of about $5.5 billion. Our monthly import bill has dropped consistently to $2.1 billion in 2016 and $1.9 billion by half year of 2017. Improvements in the capital market metrics, all share index and market capitalization recorded 32.1 and 32.3% respectively to 35,504.6 and 12.24 trillion as at August 31, 2017 from the end of December 2016 level. Improvements in the doing business indicators. The World Bank's ease of doing business indicator for 2018 showed that Nigeria, with a score of 52.03, improved 24 places to rank 145 out of 190, standing above regional average score of 50.43 recorded for sub-Saharan Africa. I must note that the CBN effort reinforced the presidential initiatives to improve ease of doing business in Nigeria. The establishment, nurturing and administration of the Credit Bureau and the National Collateral Registry contributed in no small measure an improvement of access to credit and enhancing the ease of doing business in Nigeria. In addition, the introduction of the transparent investors and exporters FX window, which boosted investors' confidence and eased market sentiment, also buoyed our doing business indicator. Boost in local production. Due to the dogged implementation of our FX restriction on certain items, we have recorded spectacular improvements in domestic production of most of these items. Local manufacturers are reporting major boosts to their revenues and profit due to the policy. To give some examples, there's a company called Salfri International Limited, an agro-allied manufacturing company based in Oyo. This company produces starch. Before the introduction of the restriction on FX 41 items, this company had just few customers and plenty of backlog inventory.
Today, the company boasts of over 50 multinational clients, including Nestle and Unilever as its clients. The company has saved Nigeria $7 million in foreign exchange drawdown over the 2 years of this policy. This policy has even freed Nigeria from a perennially embarrassing import of toothpicks. You all recall that when the Fortune items was introduced, the economists came out and said, we're just going around the room and we found toothpick and just added toothpick into the list. And how cheeky that was. But let me say that Beton Nigeria Limited, a company that is situated in Ogun State, has already taken advantage of the policy and is now producing high quality competitive toothpick that is 25% cheaper than their Chinese competition. Today we have a group of young people, young school leavers, somewhere in the outskirts of Abuja that produces toothpick, creating jobs not only for themselves but some others. A few months ago, somebody brought me a made in Nigeria pencil, made from just simply lead. It sounds very simple, but it is very frustrating and shameful that Nigeria, with its potentials, the largest economy in Africa, imports pencils. But I'm happy that today Nigeria produces its own pencils. As most of you know, or may know, at the beginning of the issue of 41 items, I usually talk about recalling with nostalgic feeling that as a credit officer, I once went to Unilever Agbara factory to inspect Unilever producing Blue Band margarine. Sometime as a result of certain challenges, and also I used the word because we let down our guards, Unilever closed down its Blue Band margarine factory in Agbara and went and set up that industry in Ghana. So what did that mean? That we exported jobs to Ghana, but impoverished and created unemployment in our country. Unilever moved its Blue Band production facility to Ghana some years ago, which means that we have to import this product from that country with scarce foreign exchange. But as part of the gains from our policy and in line with an agreement that we reached with Unilever, the company will be commissioning a new Blue Band margarine factory in Agbara early next month. To say for as many companies as there are available who have had the kind of challenges that Unilever has had, that who feel that they would like to bring back or resuscitate their factory or their manufacturing plants, you can count on Central Bank of Nigeria for support. I will be visiting Unilever to commission that plant with them and celebrate this. We have also seen a sharp drop in imports of rice from several countries. To give you an example, data from Thailand's Rice Exporters Association indicate that in 2012, about 1.2 million metric tons of rice was exported to Nigeria from Thailand. But in 2016, which was the first full year of implementation of our policy, the rice export to Nigeria from Thailand had dropped by 99% to only 784 metric tons. This significant reduction in import of rice from Thailand represents a saving of over $600 million to Nigeria in 2016 alone. is heartwarming to note that these fall in imports have been largely fueled by a boost in local rice production. For example, employees of Labana Rice in Kebbi State are trying to keep pace with demand, processing 320 tons of rice a day, a 250% increase from the previous year. From Kano, Umza Rice Limited has expanded its milling capacity substantially to the extent that with the recent bumper paddy harvest, the company today restates delivery of over 100 trucks of paddy rice daily for milling. These are clearly verifiable successes of government's attempt to create jobs locally and improve the wealth of our rural community, improve industrial capacities, and ultimately attain economic growth for our country. Now, the exogenous globe, what I'm trying to do here to do a comparative assessment looking at other emerging markets. The exogenous global shocks which affected Nigeria beginning from 2014 also impacted a number of comparator emerging market economies. In assessing our recovery efforts and current outcomes, the Nigerian economy fared comparatively well when juxtaposed with peers. Similar to key markets like Brazil, Russia, and South Africa, Nigeria exited recession in 2017. But a quick analysis indicates that Nigeria's recovery, measured by annualized GDP acceleration at 2.04% point, was fourth largest among emerging markets. This shows that from a contraction of 1.49% during the second quarter of 2016, Nigeria's economy expanded by 0.55% during the second quarter of 2017. The best recovery in terms of GDP was observed in Argentina, whose GDP growth improved 4.4 percentage points from minus 3.7% during the second quarter of 2016 to 0.3% during the second quarter of 2017. This was followed by Brazil and Russia. South Africa's recovery index at 0.8 percentage points was seventh in the ranking. In terms of inflation moderation among emerging markets, our performance with disinflation was also comparable, although the rate remained double digits. Nigeria's inflation rate fell from 17.6% in August 2016 to 16% in August 2017. Thus, annualized rate of disinflation at minus 1.6 percentage points compares favorably with other emerging market economies. In terms of rate of disinflation, while we lag behind Brazil and Russia, we outperform South Africa, Chile, and China. Now, for 2018, what do we think? Ladies and gentlemen, I must be quick to remind us that though the current developments in macroeconomy are welcome, we as leaders and policymakers must neither become complacent nor overconfident. We must strive to improve and sustain the pace of recovery. For one, our import bill may have fallen, but our manufacturing and agriculture sectors still have a long way to go if we must attain self-sufficiency in those sectors. We must not be quick to discard the restrictive measures which aided our recovery simply because the metrics have begun to improve. At the CBN, we will continue to fine-tune our policies and strategies based on our understanding of evolving developments and supported by in-house technical analysis and simulations. We will remain proactive in ensuring that the welfare of Nigerians is optimized at every point. In my personal understanding of current developments and our assessment of the traverse of future outcomes, we expect that, bearing any unforeseen circumstances or shocks, in terms of inflationary pressure, we will continue to ease. I believe that inflation may return to very low double digit or high single digit levels during the next year. Though the base effects are diminished, we expect that as the social economic factors that are driving food inflation as resolved, the inertia therein would dissipate and the pace of headline disinflation will begin to grow. In terms of FX reserves, we believe the reserves will continue to grow. Over the last 12 months, Nigeria's FX reserves grew by over 10 billion from just over 23 billion in October 2016 to over 23 billion that we currently see. It is our belief that if we remain resolute with our efforts, policies and actions, we can attain an FX reserve position of close to 40 billion by the end of 2018. Economic recovery will consolidate. As sentiments improve in the macroeconomy and supported by proactive monetary policy, trade, industrial and fiscal policies, we expect a continued uptick in gross domestic product with a positive spillover to improve unemployment rate. As policies to strengthen the agricultural and industrial sectors become more emergent, growth in these sectors will rise, further bolstering overall economy. Exchange rate stability will continue. As we entrench and sustain the transparency in the FX market, as FX reserve accretion continues, and as market confidence and improved sentiment remain, we expect that the exchange rate will not only be stable, but will begin to appreciate against major currencies. The adverse competitiveness outcome, which such appreciation may entail, will be adequately mitigated by proactive policies to ensure that our balance of payments position is not undermined. We also believe monetary policy stance will change when the underlying fundamentals become supportive, if the pace of disinflation becomes adequate, and we see inflation at predicted levels. I am very optimistic, because I know that's what most people are waiting to hear, that the Monetary Policy Committee may begin to see strong justification for an easing of monetary policy, which may further accelerate the economic recovery process through reduced interest rates. Now, strong policy coordination. Finally, I expect a redoubling of strong policy coordination, collaboration and cooperation, which flourished during the very difficult times. To sustain our recovery, the need is greater now than ever for a robust policy coordination between the key aspects of economic policy making space. In Nigeria, this will include fiscal monitoring, exchange and trade policies, which must be targeted at protecting farmers and local manufacturers to boost agricultural output, support local companies, and enhance manufacturing and industrial capacities with a view to diversifying the economy away from oil and fossil fuels. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, while we still have much work to do, I'm delighted that some of the pains that were associated with some of CBN's policies have become major gains in our economy today. We have seen many manufacturers bounce back from near comatose to running ships We have seen many farmers smiling to the banks and going back to their farmlands in due seasons. We have seen some young Nigerians entering the rice farming space rather than wait for white collar jobs. And we have seen palm oil corporations declare unprecedented profits because of the CBN's policies. On this and other basis, I believe we can build the Nigeria of our dreams. I call on all of us this evening to set aside our complaints and difficulties and distractions, and let us work together to create this Nigeria where balanced growth and shared prosperity is guaranteed for us and for our children and generations to come. I thank you all for listening.
When we don't do the second toast, you can walk out. We get two toasts there, we'll do the first one. You're welcome, Dr. Mili.
Commissioner means law appeals, so please step forward and propose the talk. and they will go from strength to strength. And indeed, one-fifth of the businesses listed on the FTSE 100 are also operational in Nigeria. This year has been a great one for financial sectors in terms of the relationship between Britain and Nigeria. On the London Stock Exchange, we've seen a $100 billion Eurobond. We've seen the first ever diaspora bond, which raised $300 million. And indeed, EcoBank launched the first Africa convertible bank bond on the London Stock Exchange, raising $250 million of private investments. But that's just the financial sectors. In the business area, we are committed from going strength to strength. And indeed, just this evening, as we speak, the UK Prime Minister's trade envoy is about to board a flight back to London, having spent 2 days in Lagos exploring business opportunities, particularly in agriculture and infrastructure, on the back of two missions to the UK. The first in agriculture was led by the Honourable Minister of Agriculture and six governors in Nigeria. So our business relationships are going to go from strength to strength. We're committed to make that happen. And in just 10 days' time, we have UK Export Finance that's coming here to Lagos, and hopefully meeting as many of you as possible from the banking sector to think about how UK Export Finance can forge bonds with banks here to further support UK exports and investments. That is the business sector, but of course our relationship goes much beyond. And it is a wonderful honor for me to be here.
Governor of Lagos State,
ably represented by the Secretary to Government, Mr. Tunji Bello, please join me in putting your hands together to appreciate this gentleman. For the man of the day, I can see joy in success. And we want to thank God for Nigeria. Sir, we want to see that hard work yields better results. And God will continue to make you to excel. You have given hope today that Nigeria rise again. Let this join hands together for the governor of Central Bank of Nigeria, Mr. Gordon Ebefore. Thank you so much. If you take me another long time, like the address of the governor, to actually complete my vote of thanks, but permit me to say that for everybody, for all of you, if you look at time, it's almost 10:15, and no one is ready to leave. It's something of joy for us, and we will continue to serve on this joy forever. Just look at the next man or woman sitting beside you, and extend your hand up to say, I congratulate you for being in Nigeria. Say it aloud. I congratulate you for being in Nigeria. And I congratulate you for being here today. The governor is doing it more than everybody. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Our forefathers, our leaders, the president and chairman of council, a man of many parts, we want to say thank you to you. You have led us well, and we can assure you, next year, you will see another one. The Lord will continue to help all of us. Thank you. Bless
you. We adore you. We appreciate you for this occasion. We then appreciate the Almighty Allah for the Yes, Institute. Allahumma rabbana atina fi dunya hasanata wa fil akhirati hasanata wa qina adhaban nar. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wassalamu ala al-mursalin walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
No, sir, I'm not too much. All right. So if you have enough money.
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
All right. My president.
Tony.
Sir. Huh?